Hello, my name is John Amabile. Thank you for joining me for my Chapter 7 video from my book, Changing the Worlds, The For-Profit Plan to Mine Asteroids and Terraform Two Planets in One Human Lifetime. So in Chapter 6, I explained atomic mining, which is basically the process of removing huge amounts of ice from an asteroid or a small moon using fusion devices. In particular, for terraforming Venus, a man named Paul Birch wrote a paper called Terraforming Venus Fast, where he went into the math and he found that basically 4.2 E to the 20 kilograms of water, if it entered Venus's atmosphere, would thermalize. So under the intense heat, the oxygen and hydrogen bonds would break. And then the hydrogen that would be left over would be sufficient to convert the CO2 that Venus currently has. And when you were done, all that you would have would be inert carbon, oxygen, water, and then the nitrogen that Venus has on it already. And this would create a breathable atmosphere under similar gravity to Earth. So I'm basically using all of that math, except that I am providing the ice with 11,000 fusion devices. So we're removing the whole crust of the asteroid Ceres, which is ice. And if we need additional ice, there's other smaller asteroids in the main asteroid belt, or the moon of Saturn, Iapetus, has more than enough ice as well. So anyway, this is how we provide the ice. As each piece is broken off, it's then guided to Mars, where a gravity assist is performed. We basically get free energy, so we don't have to use nuclear thermal rockets to push it as much. Then it goes to Venus. We'll also cover these with aluminum foil on the surface of Ceres. Aluminum foil, of course, can be made paper thin. It's not very expensive. And we can even take an asteroid that's rich in bauxite and push it towards Ceres. Even a 5-kilometer asteroid would be more than enough to cover the whole Ceres, the whole surface of Ceres with aluminum. Now, on this schematic, I do not have it covered in aluminum. At this part of the phase, the aluminum's already been removed. I didn't want to make this presentation too long. But in either case, just before it comes down on Venus, there's no aluminum. It's just a big hunk of ice. We've built blast tunnels into the inside of it. Combat engineers in the Army do things like this all the time. So you design something to have artificial weak points so that when an explosion occurs, the explosion is channeled the way that you want. My brother's a combat engineer in the Army, and they actually even will set charges on a tree so that the tree falls in a particular direction in order to block a road. Explosions are far more controllable than a person that doesn't work with demolitions probably thinks. And there's no reason that nuclear explosions cannot be as well controlled either. We just don't normally use them that way on Earth. So anyway, we've now detonated this device. We take a 60-kilometer ice object, and we blast it into thousands of 2 to 3 kilometer objects. And again, we don't cut them out all the way in the ice. We simply weaken them in the same way that when you get a bill in the mail and it has a perforated piece of paper, so it's easier for you to tear it out. So we simply perforate 1,000 objects within the larger one. When the blast occurs, all the blast tunnels intersect at the same point, so that enormous amount of pressure and energy will travel down those blast tunnels and will push the 1,000 or 2,000 objects apart. That we'll do this with enough standoff so that they will be able to spread out and come down all over Venus, but it will be close enough that all of them will actually hit Venus. Between the gravity and the size of Venus, we can do it where none of them will be able to miss. So we'll do this basic procedure 5,500 times. So each of these, I name these large objects a megapilli, and then these tunnels, there will be a tesser, a tunneling extrasolar, extra-surface reactor, which will make the large tunnel down which the fusion device is placed. And then these smaller tunnels will be what I call, will be made by an M-tesser, a micro-tunneling extra-surface reactor. So something like about 1 centimeter across, like the diameter of a pencil. But we would have thousands of them all over this asteroid, and the energy from the hydrogen device would be channeled down these holes. Relatively inexpensive. We're just talking about melting ice. The vacuum of space, we can harness that for the depressurization to move it out of the way. So we get a small metal heating source, we heat the ice, we expose that to the vacuum of space, which sucks the ice out. We can even use the ice later. We can kind of divert it where when the suction of space channels it all into one spot. So we can conserve it on the surface out of the way. And we can use, because we're doing these one at a time, not 5,500 at a time, we can use the same set of equipment. So we use one set of equipment, cut the ice out, blast it free. While it's en route to Venus, we have another set of equipment that tweaks the orbit, or tweaks the telemetry, rather, nuclear thermal rockets. Then a third set of equipment that cuts all the tunnels out. When all those pieces are done, they go back and work on the next one. So it would be like an assembly line. It would save us an enormous amount in development costs, maintenance, etc. We'd have the same pieces doing this over and over again. Finally, when the ice comes down, I'll get into the chemistry a bit. So as the ice enters the atmosphere, obviously you heat up ice, it turns into water, not very complex. But under the intense heat of reentry, now the Russians found this out during the Venera program, that the heat of entry into Venus is around 10,000 degrees Celsius. So, and they know this because they had a bunch of their probes burn up until they got to around the 11,000 degrees Celsius resistance point, in which case they were able to make the surface. Now, under 6,000 degrees Celsius, water will thermalize. So we enter the atmosphere way above the 6,000 degree point. All of the water will thermalize. It'll split from, you start with H2O, carbon in the Venusian atmosphere, nitrogen in the Venusian atmosphere. Your H2O splits, so you get just hydrogen and then oxygen from the water. I've shuffled these around, but it's the same contents. And then down here, you get it recombines, but you get the hydrogen will steal the oxygen from the carbon. This is the Bosch reaction, BOSCH. It's been around for about 120 years. But yes, this math actually does work out. It's based on the entropy points of these different elements as they fuse and react. Well, anyway, when we're done, we'll be left with water, enough water for an ocean on Venus, solid carbon, which has no greenhouse gas effects, and this would be dust. So eventually it would just fall down to the surface or be washed out when it rains on Venus as well. We'd also be left with breathable oxygen and nitrogen, just like we have on Earth. In the chapter 4 Venus, I deal with how to actually do biologic terraforming after this. I also discuss photonic terraforming. Basically, we would be buffering out some of the sunlight and the radiation using a large device made from leftover mining material in the Venusian Lagrange Point 1. But anyway, this is a kind of short and brief explanation of Chapter 7 from my book. If you have any questions, feel free to leave comments on my YouTube channel or to email me. Or, of course, if you go to my website, you could buy the book and get the whole Chapter 7 text. Thank you and have a good night.